Well, there's some breaking news. There's loads of stuff to talk about. The first thing that happened yesterday now, or the day before, was the announcement of Eubank Jr. The other way around now, isn't it? It's Liam Smith versus Eubank Jr., the rematch. Are you surprised that this rematch did actually happen? Are you excited about it? What was your initial thought when you heard about the rematch?
No, I always thought after the first fight, I know that Chris had the rematch clause, and I always thought he'd enforce it. There was big interest there the first time round. Obviously, there was rumours about him fighting Conor Benn, Chris Amin, obviously. But no, I'm not shocked we're seeing it a second time. You know, there was big interest in the first fight. This fight's probably bigger now, isn't it, with the result, Liam Smith? So no, I'm looking forward to it. The first fight was very interesting, and I expect the second to be as well.
Now, you picked Eubank Jr. the first time round, as a lot of people did. Obviously, we saw that outcome, which nobody expected, even the people. I mean, I was picking Liam, but I didn't expect that, a fourth round knockout. No chance, I didn't expect that. But with it being such an emphatic win, you've said you're looking forward to that, but with it being such an emphatic win, do you think that's taken the luster a little bit off the rematch?
Not really. I mean, yeah, you're right. It was such an emphatic win. Would I rule Chris Jr. out winning the return? No, I wouldn't. You know, it was a fantastic shot that took him out. And this is boxing. These things can happen. So I think you've got to back Liam Smith. You've got to make him the favourite. But would I rule Chris Jr. out? Certainly not. You know, some people have said that to this week, you know, when the fight got announced, don't rule Chris out. And they're like, oh, no, you're joking. He'll murder him again. But you never know. Boxing's a funny old sport. Chris still is a good fighter. And I certainly won't rule him out in the return.
With that being said, then, what does he have to do? I mean, aside from the obvious of not getting hit in that manner, but what does he... Has he got the repertoire to deal with a Liam Smith? You said you're not going to rule him out, so fair enough. So what would he have to change?
I think in the first fight, you know, as Chris underestimated, I'm not sure. We certainly can't use that as an excuse because they're both very experienced fighters. But he was having success in the fight. You know, I was edging him the early rounds and he was showing some nice skills in there. Right up until the point he got caught. The first time he caught him clean, he took him out. But before that, he was having his moments of success. So, I think he'll go in there with a similar game plan. He'll aim to go in there and try and box. He was having success in the first fight, right up until he caught him.
There are some fighters in British boxing who have been given this granite chin mantle. You are actually one of them. That sort of illusion was destroyed in that fight. He's now, I don't know if you saw any of the build-up. I watched the press conference and he said something about he wants Roy Jones Jr. not to bring the towel to the fight. He wants to go out on his stretcher. What do you make of those type of comments? And what do you make of that mindset that he felt it was stopped premature and actually wanted to go out concussively?
Yeah, he... No, it was a fair stoppage, wasn't it, Aki? I don't think it was a bad stoppage at all. It was a fair stoppage. And that was always one of Chris Jr.'s things, wasn't it? That granite chin. Always very, very tough. And that's sort of gone now. Has it taken away his confidence? I know, you know, I've been around boxing a long time. There's some fighters, once they do get taken out, once they do get chinned and KO'd, sometimes they're never quite the same. So again, lots of unknowns. But he's certainly shown that granite chin maybe he's gone now. And that was always one of his big, big assets, wasn't it? So, you know, Liam's going to go into this fight full of confidence. Will there be demons there in Chris's head? I'm not too sure. But like I've just touched on, some fighters have come back from defeat once they've been knocked out and not been quite the same. You know, boxing's been littered with that, actually, in fact. So will we see it again?
If he loses this fight, the one in Manchester, the rematch, is it time to call it a day?
Absolutely. I mean, if he loses this fight, it would definitely be the right time for Chris to call it a day.
It's an interesting one, of course, as well. On the undercard, Savannah Marshall returns against, in an undisputed fight against Franchon Cruz. So it looks like, I mean, it's great to see Manchester having some big cards again. It, you know, back in your day, I was actually looking at a fight poster the other day. Whose gym was it in? I can't remember what gym it was in. It was you, Gomez, Ricky, or it might have been Ricky. It was Arnie Farnell. It was like Tommy McDonough. I was just thinking, what a card this is. I mean, do you miss those days of those massive Manchester nights?
You just reeled off a few names there, and I'm smiling just thinking about it. They were great days, weren't they? Great nights. Yeah. Boxing was in the Manchester area was really booming then. And there's some good fighters about now. So, yeah, there's more and more big shows coming back to the MEN. And hopefully them glory days can return because, like you say, you was just reeling those names off there and sat here smiling. They were great days, mate. They really was. And hopefully they can come back because there's some very, very good fighters coming through Manchester at the minute. They seem to be putting on more shows at the MEN. I know Boxer certainly put a lot of shows on at the MEN. Matchroom maybe don't put on quite as many, but hopefully the glory days can come back to Manchester because they were great, great nights. And the fan base is there, you know, these people there. And I think they're just itching to get behind the fighters.
Yeah, definitely some good talent coming through. Bring me to my next point then, obviously, Campbell's last fight. He's definitely getting out more regularly now. I know we're about to discuss his next fight date, but his last performance, Louis Fielding, that was a good body shot, that. That was a real... That was probably... I mean, well, I'm probably putting words in your mouth here, but for me, it was just like the best uptick we've seen in the performances. But how did you reflect on that? It's only a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, he's getting better and better now, Campbell. For me, it was always a case of when, not if, because Campbell is a quality fighter. I've seen it for a long time in the gym, where he's making significant improvements now. I always said he would. You know, let's get in the real world. Lewis Fielding, there's going to be bigger fights ahead. But also, he was boxing at area level. He'd boxed 10 rounds a couple of times. He'd fought for the Midlands area title, lost out by a point. And Campbell was boxing well very early in that fight, catching him cleanly and took him out with a fantastic body shot. So Campbell's showing big improvements now, and it shows the level he's at. You know, that kid had fought for the Midlands area title and lost in a close fight. And you can't get away with it. You know, Campbell's got his knockers, but he blew him away in a round. And he's showing big, big improvements lately. And that's continuing in the gym again now.
Now, there were the build-up to that fight, there was, I think there was trying to be a bit of a narrative built-up, not from the fighters themselves, actually, but a bit of a narrative built-up around, well, some of the people were asking Campbell and people around a fight with a local rival in Aki Fiaz. Now, I don't know how that it got into that, but, you know, is that something that you guys were actually interested in? Is it something you were told about, you know, we're going to try and build this up, or is it just something that happened spontaneously?
No, I just think it, you know, possibly a few of the local fight fans have mentioned it, and it seems to have snowballed. It's never a fight that's been particularly on our radar, to be honest. Aqib is a really good fighter. I like Aqib. He's a great lad. Campbell and Aqib were actually former gym mates at Northside when Campbell was boxing them. So it's never really been a fight that's been on our radar. I can see what people are saying. You know, maybe they're drifting a little bit further apart in weights now. Campbell's going to be boxing at light welterweight from here on in. We certainly won't be moving back from here. I know Akib's fighting at super featherweight at the minute. Maybe he'll go up in weight. And it could be a possible fight down the line. But weight-wise, I think like the two weight divisions apart at the minute, say Akib was to come up, in weight or a couple of weights, I don't know. You know, certainly never say never in boxing. You know, it'd be a big draw in Manchester. There'd be plenty of interest in it, as the discussion's already showing. But it's not really a fight that's on our radar at the minute, but who knows?
Is there anything that's on your radar? Because obviously he's creeping up there now into number of fights. He's got some decent experience behind him now. As you said, he's getting better with every fight. How far away, conceivably, do you think he is from central area sort of title fight, maybe, or if that is something that is interests you?
Absolutely. You know, this is fight number 12 coming up for Campbell now. is showing significant improvements. You know, a couple of first round stoppages in the last three fights, a good six rounder thrown in there as well. In an ideal scenario, I'd like Campbell to get a couple more eight rounders. And then who knows, you know, there's some good local talent, there's some good local matches. And again, I think probably in an ideal world for me, get a couple of good learning eight rounders against good quality opposition, and then maybe look towards an area title or something of that sort back end of the year, early next. Campbell's still only 22, let's not forget. And it's one of those things in boxing, once you move forward, there's no turning back. So slowly, but realistically, yeah, a couple more eight rounders for Campbell, and then maybe look for an area title fight for him.
It must be sort of surreal for you guys still. I know we've mentioned this before, just being on this journey with Campbell, because we did Chris did a sit down podcast with Kerry Kays the other day, and
I've just finished watching it this morning. What a great watch. I mean, in boxing, not in just in boxing, in my life, Kerry's one of the best people I've met. He really is such an interesting character. And I was listening to that, and there were some stories there even I haven't heard. What an interesting life, and what a great guy. One of them guys where Kerry's only ever helped me, you know, only ever helped me, and he still does to this day. He wants nothing in return. A great guy. And like I say, for anyone listening to this, have a listen to that, because it's what an interesting, what a great guy.
It's class. And some of the stories he was talking about, I've just been watching it myself, talking about Dana White hooking Ricky up with a gym in like Vegas and all that sort of stuff. I mean, those we don't rarely see fighters now from the UK actually going and fighting over in Vegas and fighting in America on these big cards. Those were some days, weren't they?
They were. I tell you what, Kerry, never mind. I tell you what, Aki, never mind that. I'm glad he wasn't telling the Tenerife tales, because we used to have a few trips away to Tenerife after the fights, mate. So I'm glad he wasn't revealing them.
We had to edit them out, actually, mate, because some of the stuff he said about you was probably criminal.
Oh, yeah. Jesus Christ, I hope they don't surface.
Elsewhere in your stable, I caught up with Hash Rahman the other day. He was chatting to him at one of the boxing matches. He's got an eye-catching style. What's next for Hash?
He's going to be fighting July now. Hash is a really good fighter, as you touched on there. Very exciting. I know Steve Woods is very exciting. You know, Steve's got a big stable of fighters. I think Steve manages 50, 60 fighters. And he speaks very... I know he really wants to push Hash forward. He would have probably fought in April, but he was on Ramadan, unfortunately. So Hash will be fighting now, middle of July. So we've got Campbell fighting in May, and then Hash mid-July in Doncaster. So he's another fighter who've got high hopes for. And again, probably a name that guys don't particularly know, but such an exciting fighter to watch. And I just get a feeling with Hash, you get a feeling with some fighters, I think he's going to turn out to be a real danger man, I do.
I think so. I mean, first time I watched him was ringside in Oldham, and I stopped and watched the whole fight, and I thought, wow, he's really entertaining to watch. I did see, I'm not going to, you know, say, you know, he's like you and he's going to get to your level, etc. But there were some similarities there that I saw, you know, especially with the body work.
Again, some of the way he works that body and the way he skips around and does it so naturally, like you say, it was something that I was always encouraged. It reminded me a little bit of our kid as well, the way he worked that body, the way he skipped around. And it's not something that I've taught him. I can't take credit for that. It's just something that he does naturally, and he does it so well. So obviously I encourage it.
And your lad, Jack, every time I go on a social media thing, he's won another fight. He's going at great guns at the minute.
He is. He's having more fights than Chuck Norris. He tells me when to. That was wild. Fight number 16 in just over a year. So he's won 14 of those 16 bouts, and he's taken to it really, really well. He absolutely loves it. It's been so good for him as a person. Again, boxing's worked its magic with his confidence and everything like that, his discipline. And I'm starting to get excited about Jack because he's so in such promise. He really is. Again, yeah, follow the journey. He's getting a cracking little following behind him. He's such a nice kid as well. And he absolutely loves it. And he's going great guns at the minute. So yeah, fair play to him. Keep working hard, and let's see where it goes.
Is it mixed emotions knowing that he wants a career in boxing? I know his Nana Carol's got mixed emotions about it. I mean, she's a nervous watcher anyway. But has, you know, being a fighter yourself and being cut and being, you know, being in big fights and being hurt, has that just made you desensitize a little bit to being a nervous watcher?
Not really. I mean, again, I said it with Campbell as well. I didn't want Campbell. I didn't want Jack to box because it's such a hard, tough, brutal sport, professional boxing. But boxing's been good to me. It's been good to Ricky. And they both really want to do it. So if they want to do it, who are we to say, no, you can't do it, or try and put them off when it's been so good to us? There's dangers in anything these days. There's dangers in any walk of life. But, you know, you can't change who you are. There's just something that's in them both to do it. And if they want to do it, and I'm in a position, and Ricky's in a position to help them and to get behind them and give them our wealth of experience, then certainly if they show that they want to do it, that's what I'm going to do. And I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying it at the minute. Both boys work really hard, committed. So yeah, let's see where the journey takes them both.
Do you believe it? Do you believe in boxing being in someone's DNA then? Because obviously there must be something in that, because obviously look at you and Ricky. Then there's Campbell coming along. Then there's Jack coming along. Or do you think it's a product of the environment they're brought in? I know it's a bit of a deep sort of question, but, you know.
Oh, no. It's a great question, mate. Probably a bit of both. You know, even though they've not been encouraged to box, they've been around it, they've seen it. And again, you can't change who you are. You know, I've got older now. I've got my own kids. I've seen the dangers of the sport from inside and outside the ropes. And I know the dangers in boxing. Would I go and do it all over again? I wish I could in a heartbeat. You know, you can't change who you are. You are who you are. You've got to embrace it. And I know the dangers of boxing, and I wish I could go and do it all over again. So if the boys want to box and I'm in a position to help them, I'll certainly get behind them.